Thank you for coming to our 16th annual Alexander Hamilton Awards. This has become a very seminal event for the Institute, where we honor the most distinguished people in the city and the country who have made their contributions to our politics and to our civic society. And to begin that program tonight, it is my distinct honor and pleasure to introduce the chairman of the Manhattan Institute, Mr. Paul Singer.
Welcome, everyone. I'm afraid I have bad news for some of you. This is not Hamilton the Musical. This dinner tradition began in 2001. So the Manhattan Institute was celebrating Hamilton way before it was cool. Also, the tickets to this are cheaper than that to the musical. Notwithstanding that, we've raised over $2.2 million for this event for the Manhattan Institute. I feel the need to begin tonight by saying a word or two about the current political situation. If you will, a form of group therapy. I had a number of comedic riffs ready to go, but it occurred to me that it's not such a funny time. In fact, this is a difficult time, and in some respects a bleak time in the political life of America, for reasons that I don't need to rehash for you. A period of tremendous challenges when so much we cherish threatens to be scrambled and perhaps undone. It's essential that we, individually, collectively, and through our institutions, stand up for what we believe, which is not embodied, actually, in either choice that will be on the menu in November. One of those choices is Clintonism, of course, representing, as it does, a classical, dynastic, crony leftism and legally oblivious autocracy. The second is Trumpism, whatever in the blizzard of insults and head-spinning uninformed policy statements that Trumpism may actually be. Just consider what Trump has said in the past 72 hours as policy prescriptions, making a deal on the national debt instead of paying it in full. Alexander Hamilton, are you listening? Raising taxes, raising the minimum wage, imposing more tariffs, and expanding executive branch authority even more than Obama. For Trump to be the opposition's response to 8 years of Obama, is extraordinary. I get confused. Both Mr. Trump and Mrs. Clinton are signs of philosophical, policy, and political exhaustion. They epitomize the politics of anger and nostalgia, of visceral responses, of tearing down rather than building up. It's an unpleasant choice for sure, but in the event that nothing can be done about the choice that America faces in November, then certainly out of the ashes of this year, there will be an opening for revitalized conservatism, one that respects the Constitution and limited government, that promotes economic growth, and encourages human excellence, one which supports the dispersion of power rather than its concentration in the unaccountable elite, one that will stand with our allies and stand strongly but wisely against our enemies. I believe all of that, not because I am of a Pollyanna persuasion, in fact, I promise that's not my disposition, but because I believe in America and its extraordinary capacity for renewal. But self-renewal requires us once again to embrace the right ideas and believe in their power to change the world. Which brings me to the Manhattan Institute. The Manhattan Institute has made extraordinary contributions to the intellectual life of America. It is home to some of the world's greatest scholars, and it produces City Journal, the nation's premier urban policy magazine. With so much up in the air, and with so many fundamental debates unfolding, with the meaning and future of conservatism at stake, the Manhattan Institute's work has never been more urgent. It has such important things to say to us as a country and as a city. Consider public safety. For decades, the Institute has worked to advance broken windows policing here in New York and working with police departments around the country. The New York Police Department, through its proactive policing, has saved thousands of lives. As MI senior fellow Heather McDonald has said, quote, "There is no institution in New York more dedicated to the proposition that black lives matter than the NYPD," close quote. I'm proud of the work the Institute has done in support of the NYPD, and proud too to have the opportunity this evening to thank the two men who have made New York City the safest big city in the world, former Commissioner Ray Kelly and current Commissioner William Bratton. Then we have the Manhattan Institute's Adam Smith Society and the Young Leaders Circle. These programs look for the best young people, those most likely to be leaders in business and other fields, and actively supports their education. If you're looking for a reason to be optimistic, this is it. I'd like to ask every member here of the Adam Smith Society and every member of the Young Leaders Circle to stand, please. Please join me in applauding them. These young men and women are only a handful of thousands more around the country. Supporting the Manhattan Institute means, in a very concrete way, supporting the next generation in ways that will help America flourish in the 21st century. Young people and young leaders need role models, and you could not do better than tonight's honorees, Bruce Kovner and Harvey Silverglade. As a philanthropist, Bruce Kovner has put his money where his mind is. A firm believer in educational choice, he's been a very generous backer of charter schools, expanding the opportunity for thousands of low-income kids. He's done this at a time when New York City's political leadership, for reasons that are intellectually inexplicable and morally indefensible, have declared war on charter schools. Thanks to men and women like Bruce Kovner, charter schools are fighting back for the sake of the children of New York and in order to produce excellence in education. And Bruce's support for the Juilliard School, among other iconic New York cultural institutions, has been nothing short of inspired. We're privileged tonight to have some of Juilliard's gifted musicians, and at the end of the program, they will be playing. Harvey Silverglade is one of our country's leading defenders of civil liberties, especially on our college campuses. For decades, Harvey has sounded the alarm about the threat to free speech and due process rights in higher education, as well as providing legal representation for those whose rights have been abridged. America's universities should be the home of reason, the place above all else where we can debate ideas and test theories and attend to the life of the mind. But in an Orwellian turn, colleges and universities have instead become the most closed-minded places in America. I first came across Harvey's work when I learned of students that needed funding for legal representation to defend against campus prosecutions. Those students were being prosecuted, and reality, I would say persecuted, for what the administrations considered to be the, quote, wrong, close quote, ideas. The prosecutions took place in kangaroo courts, and the punishments would have been expulsion. Harvey and his team swept in with legal representation for those students, which made a huge difference. In some cases, the administrations completely backed off and withdrew their cases in response. We are honored to have Bruce and Harvey with us here tonight as we celebrate their accomplishments and work to advance the ideas that they and the Manhattan Institute stand for. Once again, thanks all of you for being here tonight. I extend special thanks to our patron-level supporters, the Vice Chairman of the Manhattan Institute, Dr. Michael Fedak, and his wife, Marilyn. Please hold your applause until I finish the list of people who are patron level and benefactor level supporters. Laurel and Cliff Asness, Ravenel Curry, Daniel and Margaret Loeb, Diane and Tom Smith, Peter D'Angelo, and our benefactor level supporters, Timothy Dalton, Jay Newman and Elisa Kramer, the Star Foundation, Roger and Susan Hertog, Paula and Tom McInerney, Thomas and Cynthia Ogden, Spire Family Foundation, Paulson Family Foundation, Kleinberg Kaplan Wolf and Cohen, and Tom and Alex Tisch. Thank you all for your extraordinary support. Now, please enjoy your dinner, and we'll be back with you shortly to begin our program.
Thank you very much. A college bureaucrat gazing on this gathering would undoubtedly conclude that she was in a, quote, unsafe space. Luckily, our honoree tonight wouldn't have it any other way. Now, even for veteran observers of the narcissism that has engulfed American colleges, these last 6 months have been hard to take. The conceit that female and minority students are somehow unsafe on American campuses has reached appalling proportions, threatening to obliterate any last connection between higher education and reality. Where to start? How about with the shrieking girl at Yale? If you haven't seen the video of this incident, count yourself lucky. A female student, part of a crowd of allegedly victimized black Yale students, screams at her college master, and I have edited the following for a family audience. Be quiet! Who the fuck hired you? Why the F did you accept the master's position? You are disgusting! Now, what provoked this student to such a fever pitch of incivility? The master's wife had sent an email gently suggesting that Yale students were capable of deciding for themselves what Halloween costumes to wear without the intervention of Yale's diversity bureaucrats. Hundreds of students rallied, demanding that Yale fire the master and his wife. At Emory University, students stormed the office of the president crying, "We are in pain." Now, what caused their great anguish? The sight of the words Trump 2016, well, we understand, we can empathize a little bit, that had been chalked on walkways throughout campus. Now, it is just possible that there are more than a few people in this very room for whom Trump 16 causes great pain. But with enormous self-discipline, rather than demanding the destruction of Trump political slogans, they argue against the wisdom of electing the Donald. The Emory students, by contrast, wanted their president to find and punish the malefactors that had caused them to feel, quote, unsafe. Now, as surreal as the present college situation is, it would be far worse, if you can imagine that, without Harvey Silvergate and the organization he founded in 1999, the Foundation for Individual Rights in Education, or FIRE. Harvey is perhaps the last representative of a nearly vanished species, an intellectually honest civil libertarian who believes in free speech for everyone. A highly sought after criminal defense and civil liberties lawyer who had defended Vietnam protesters in the 1960s. In the 1980s, Harvey noticed that something odd was happening on American college campuses. The growth of a vast bureaucracy dedicated to stamping out supposed bigotry among students by imposing speech codes and thought controls. In 1993, as Harvey will explain, he played a key role in the infamous water buffalo case at the University of Pennsylvania, which was the first time that the draconian campaign against wholly imaginary student racism caught the national attention. Harvey and his colleagues prevailed in that case, but the march of speech codes continued through American campuses, jeopardizing free inquiry and placing unfettered power in the hands of campus bureaucrats. In 1999, Harvey and Penn history professor Alan Coors created FIRE to fight the growing repression. Since then, FIRE has won every lawsuit it has brought against college speech codes. Yep. It has defended hundreds of students and professors against retaliation for their views, and it helped torpedo a catastrophic requirement that teacher education schools certify their students' commitment to social justice as a condition for graduation. And Harvey and FIRE have been at the forefront of efforts to bring fairness to grotesquely biased campus rape tribunals. The university should be the one institution that fully understands the civilizational achievement that is Anglo-American due process. Instead, it is the place where due process goes to die. How essential is FIRE? During the water buffalo case, the press and the ACLU were on the side of free speech. An ACLU attorney who worked on the case said that he couldn't wait every day to leave the University of Pennsylvania and return to the United States of America. NBC's John Chancellor complained that the, quote, bozos on American campuses were trying to destroy the English language. Now the ACLU and the press have gone virtually silent regarding the university's assault on academic freedom, leaving FIRE as the only organization fighting to restore it. When Virginia Tech recently disinvited Manhattan Institute fellow Jason Riley from a speaking engagement, thank you, Jason, inadvertently conferring on him the highest academic honor you can receive in today's topsy-turvy world. You'll get an award for this, Jason. It was undoubtedly the prospect of a fire investigation that led the benighted bureaucrats to reverse themselves and reopen the invitation. If fighting for academic enlightenment were not enough, Harvey also devotes himself to exposing abuses by overzealous prosecutors and regulators, and even has a forthcoming book on the topic entitled Conviction Machine. The campus totalitarians show no sign of slowing down, but fortunately for America, Harvey and Fire understand that the only truly safe space is individual liberty and freedom. Ladies and gentlemen, it is with great pleasure that I bring you this year's Alexander Hamilton Award recipient, Harvey Silverglate.
Thank you, Heather, and thank you, friends. This is a relatively relaxing evening for me, notwithstanding the formalities of the occasion ranging from the magnificence of this room to the august assemblage of guests. Why, you ask, do I feel so at home here? Throughout my career, I have found myself before judicial tribunals, at meetings in academic lecture halls and classrooms, where it has been obvious to me that I'd best watch my back. But tonight, I'm among friends. Not necessarily friends with whom I would agree on every point, but colleagues and allies who have joined me and with whom I have joined to fight some of the crucial cultural and political battles of our era, or indeed any era of American history. What wars? I've dedicated much of my career to two contests that are consuming our nation, the ramifications of which will impact generations to come, as well as the health of the republic itself. I'm referring to, first, the capacity of the criminal law, especially federal law, to turn all of us into criminals at the government's whim for engaging in what to us appear to be the most benign personal and professional actions or inactions. And second, the effort well underway to destroy the liberal arts university by replacing the quest for human knowledge with the indoctrination of students into truth as it is postulated by self-righteous fanatics who think they have a monopoly on human wisdom, when in fact all they really have monopolized are the levers of academic and administrative power. And with respect to these two areas, due process and fairness in criminal law, and free speech and free thought, and procedural fairness on college campuses, I've long taken comfort in the reliability of allies such as the Manhattan Institute. This is the reason that despite my reputation for accepting rather few invitations, I gratefully accepted MI's invitation to venture to New York, where, by the way, I was born, so this is not foreign territory to me, to accept, along with my co-recipient, the redoubtable Bruce Kovner, the Institute's Alexander Hamilton Award. Thank you, Manhattan Institute, and the Institute's leadership, President Larry Moen in particular, the entire board, for this honor. But even more important, for the Institute's ceaseless support for civilization and sanity in my two areas of interest. Interestingly, I noticed that dangerous trends in each of these two areas accelerated about the same time, the mid-1980s. Might the explanation, I asked myself, be that suddenly the universities were accepting a more diverse student body? Rather than celebrate this liberalization of American society and academic culture, I wondered perhaps the colleges, fearing that students of different racial, religious, and social backgrounds would clash with one another, expanded the student life bureaucracies to, in their view, keep the peace. Regardless of the attempted justification, definitions of harassment were adopted that were so vague and broad so as to escalate the numbers of disciplinary proceedings, many of which were deemed confidential so that the outside world had no idea what was happening on the campus. Speech codes popped up that sought to prevent students from insulting or offending one another. But in practice, the code strangled the academic enterprise. Kangaroo courts were established to adjudicate the many violations of the new rules. Remember that we're talking about liberal arts colleges, not prisons and not re-education camps. At about the same time, I noticed the proliferation of prosecutions in the federal courts that were ensnaring defendants who, it seemed to me, and I'm a lawyer, had conducted themselves, if not superbly, then at least well within legal limits. This ensnaring was enabled by the greatly expanded use of inherently vague federal statutes, such as fraud. The concept of fraud suddenly meant whatever a United States attorney wanted it to mean, with the target often being selected for the personal aggrandizement of the prosecutor's reputation and future job prospects, rather than for the protection of the public. The bottom line was that I saw that these major institutions, the college campuses and the federal courts, took a turn toward precepts and practices that furnished a nutrient-laden petri dish for an experiment in an authoritarianism that was very different from the America I was familiar and comfortable with. The Foundation for Individual Rights in Education's co-founders, University of Pennsylvania's Professor Alan Charles Kors and I, established FIRE in 1999, a year after Professor Kors and I published our book, The Shadow University, The Betrayal of Liberty on America's Campuses. That book followed Professor Kors' representation with some legal advice from me of an undergraduate who was being persecuted in a Penn campus tribunal in the infamous Water Buffalo case, where a well-meaning student named Eden Jacobowitz addressed a group of undergraduate women who were raucously celebrating their sorority's anniversary just outside his dorm window as he was studying. He shouted, "Shut up, you water buffalo." The women being African Americans, this was deemed by them and by student life administrators to constitute racial harassment. It turned out, actually, that in the offending student's first language, Hebrew, the common slang term behemoth reasonably translates into water buffalo and refers in the slang to a rowdy or thoughtless person. Penn's administrators, unaware of and uninterested in Jacobowitz's cultural background, assumed that the water buffalo was native to Africa. It's not. And from this, they extrapolated their hate speech theory. In the face of derisive worldwide publicity, the campus bureaucrats backed down, but it turned out this was merely a strategic retreat, not a true surrender. Sanity's well-publicized victory in the water buffalo case triggered a flood of students seeking assistance from Professor Kors and me. These beleaguered individuals were suffering not only from unfair persecutions, but also were being cheated out of a genuine liberal arts education. The liberal arts are not readily compatible with censorship and mindless ideological persecution. It is impossible to teach and to learn in the liberal arts arena under such conditions of hypersensitivity and authoritarianism. Indoctrination was replacing true academic study. From the day students arrive as freshmen, they are subjected to sensitivity training engineered by burgeoning student life bureaucrats who intrude into the students' most intimate lives and thoughts. I recognized that students and even dissenting faculty were at the mercy of a new regime, something of a cross between Kesey's One Flew Over the Cuckoo's Nest and Kafka's Trial. Kors and I could not handle the volume, and so Fire was born out of sheer necessity. I, at the time, had assumed that surely the ludicrousness, the sheer ludicrousness of the campus persecutions would result in the phenomenon burning itself out, surely within less than 10 years. It was, I told myself, a momentary social panic. Fire would be a temporary project. The burning of witches in Salem, after all, ended rather abruptly when the Supreme Judicial Court of Massachusetts decided that enough was enough and put an end to the trials in 1693. That scourge lasted but 1 year. Well, Fire is in its 17th year. With no end in sight, we are in trench warfare. The success of the Shadow University triggered my next book project. I wrote a book about the decline of justice in the federal criminal system, which I titled Three Felonies a Day, How the Feds Target the Innocent. As you might intuit, by the title, my thesis is essentially that the average American arguably commits three federal felonies in a typical day, but does not even realize it. All that is needed is an ambitious federal prosecutor, and a prosecution is born. One has to pray that his case is assigned to a judge who sees through the scam, but most do not. Like campus administrators, too many judges tend to be either cynics or true believers. And contrary to the way book projects are traditionally carried out, I went to sell the completed book manuscript to a publisher. No book proposal, rather I had the full manuscript. The publisher of the Shadow University was unwilling to take on the project. Perhaps, I wondered, for fear of the US Department of Justice, other publishers I contacted likewise turned me away, and I thought it was a pretty good manuscript, by the way. Enter my dear friend Dorothy Rabinowitz, the Pulitzer Prize-winning columnist for the Wall Street Journal, who suggested that I send the manuscript to her friend, Roger Kimball. The brilliant publisher at Encounter Books, who I see in the audience this evening and who's on the board of Manhattan Institute. Roger, who had seen some of his own friends get ensnared in these traps for the unwary, strewn throughout the ocean of vague federal statutes and regulations, agreed to publish the book. Three Felonies has become somewhat of a handbook for the counter-revolution against federal tyranny. The book's influence has been such that I recently acceded to Roger's plea that I write a sequel that would focus on proposed solutions. I'm nearly halfway through the manuscript, and Conviction Machine is due out sometime next year. In these two theaters of battle in which I find myself, reliable allies are highly valued. This is why the Manhattan Institute is so important. It recognizes the stakes in terms of liberty and of civilization itself in both the criminal justice arena and the education arena. I am proud and I am buoyed to have allies like MI. I know that FIRE likewise is grateful to have such a reliable cohort in the fight for restoration of liberty, fairness, and sanity itself on college campuses. Together we will prevail, and I thank you.
When money managers are asked what they think of Bruce Kovner, they say the same thing that Mikhail Baryshnikov said when people asked him what ballet dancers think of Fred Astaire. We hate him. But success on Wall Street, however great, is just a footnote to the reason it is so fitting that the Manhattan Institute tonight is awarding the 2016 Hamilton Prize to Bruce Stanley Kovner. Born in Brooklyn, raised in California, Bruce comes from a long line of Jewish socialists. What else is new? He came back to New York in 1973 and, like Hamilton, came with no family and no relationships. It's been said that you can come to New York to reinvent yourself. You can even be born here and reinvent yourself. And in doing so, change not only yourself, but the people around you, and possibly even the city itself. That's the Kovner story in a nutshell. To understand it, there are two pivotal moments in Bruce's life. The first came when he was 15. Driving in a car with his mother, suddenly on the radio, he heard Gustav Holst's orchestral suite, The Planets. From that moment on, he said, "Music has been the most consistent form of spiritual stimulation in my life." I must admit, at 15, I had many other interests than Holst. The second pivotal moment came when, as a scholarship student at Harvard and later at the John F. Kennedy School of Government, Bruce came under the mentorship of four extraordinary professors who, over his life in some form or another, shaped his worldview. Three of them were Ed Banfield, James Q. Wilson, and Daniel Patrick Moynihan. These men had the greatest effect on the study of American politics in modern times, challenging every aspect of what we knew and what we believed as the received wisdom of public policy. And if these three giants had not sufficed, Bruce learned history with Henry Kissinger. Three of these men, Jim Wilson, Pat Moynihan, and Henry Kissinger, have been awarded the Hamilton Prize. When Bruce returned to New York in the early 70s, with his Harvard degree in hand, he immediately got a job driving a taxi and then began trading in the financial markets with $3,000 he borrowed from his MasterCard. I should note, and I'm sure it's not surprising to you, that he was very successful in this trading venture. All the time attending the Juilliard School at night to study piano. A few years later, Bruce answered an ad. Remember, people used to do that. For a trading assistant at Commodities Corporation in Princeton, New Jersey. Obviously very impressed, they decided on the spot to hire him not as an assistant, but as a principal to trade the company's capital. The rest, as they say, is history. 5 years later, they offered Bruce the presidency of the company. But he decided to form his own hedge fund, Caxton Associates, which over the 20 years ending 2011, the year he retired, compounded its money at 21% a year versus 11% for the S&P 500. By the way, that's a very big excess return. Being a legendary manager, money manager, was never enough for Bruce Kovner. His love of music inspired his interest and his sense of obligation to support the great cultural institutions in New York. He is vice chairman of the Lincoln Center and was instrumental in the $1.2 billion redesign of its campus. He's also managing director of the Metropolitan Opera Board of Directors. But the cultural institution, which he had the greatest passion for, is the Juilliard School, which provides the highest caliber of artistic education for gifted students from about 45 countries around the world. Bruce joined its board in the mid-1990s and was asked to become chairman in 2001, at which time he began a remarkable partnership with its president, Joe Polisi, Juilliard's president. Joe is with us tonight. Joe, please stand. Together, they transformed Juilliard in many ways. But the one that stands out to me, they really helped create a global institution. In 2013, Bruce and Susie Kovner, in inspired philanthropic vision, endowed the Kovner Fellowships, which provide full tuition and all related expenses annually for 52 young men and women at Juilliard. But Bruce's interest in education didn't end with the arts. In 1998, as a part of a small group, he persuaded the then governor of New York, George Pataki, to pass New York State's first charter school law. That's why today, if you can believe it, there are 100,000 students in charter schools in New York City. It wouldn't have happened without the initiative of Bruce and seeing what could happen with the idea of communicating, developing relationships with political figures of significance. Bruce and Susie are also among the principal donors to Success Academy, the leading charter school network in New York. Its president has also been a Hamilton Prize winner. And I think Eva is with us tonight. Eva, would you please stand? And yet there's another aspect that remains unsung. Bruce is a man of ideas, interested in public policy and the intersection with politics. He's advanced these ideas on the board of the American Enterprise Institute since 1989, serving as chairman of AEI for 6 years, and he also served on the board of the Manhattan Institute for over a decade. To paraphrase John Adams, I must study war and politics so my sons may study economics and business, so that their sons may study music and art. Incredibly, Bruce Kovner has lived out this whole cycle in one lifetime. For this, his generosity, his love for New York, Bruce Kovner's strategic philanthropic ideas is something we can all learn from. He is, in my view, a role model that we can all take something from. Like Hamilton, he came here to reinvent himself, and in doing so, influence the people and influence the city itself. Now, any of us who have been involved in these aspects of life knows that it's hard and often lonely. And it helps immeasurably to have the right kind of partner. Bruce is blessed with such a partner and a friend, his wife, Susie Kovner. Susie, please stand. Ladies and gentlemen, it's now my privilege to introduce Bruce Kovner.
Well, thank you, Roger. I was a bit over the top, but it's okay. It was very generous, and I'm just thrilled to be back here at the Manhattan Institute again. Thank you, Paul and Larry, and the Manhattan Institute board. I've been such a big fan of the Hamilton Award and its recipients. As Roger said, three of my undergraduate professors made their way up here to receive the award, but so many great New Yorkers have, and it's a measure of the Manhattan Institute's vision and scope that not only Pat Moynihan, Bill Buckley, Bob Bartley, Jim Wilson, Dick Gilder, Roger Hertog, Eva Moskowitz, people who have contributed intellectually to understanding the problems of public policy, but also people who made a difference in the practice of public policy in New York and made the city a much better place. They inspire all of us, I think, and they certainly have over the years inspired me, so it's a thrill to be even last on the list, and I'm really delighted. But the other reason I'm thrilled to be up here is MI has made such important contributions to the life of the city through its scholarship, through creating a community of concerned and principled thinkers, and also by creating institutions that have made a difference, especially the City Journal, which is without peer. I look forward to every issue. It actually reminds me of the time to call out another example of an amazing journal. I remember waiting with Ed Banfield and Jim Wilson for every issue of The Public Interest, which Bill Kristol's father, Irving Kristol, founded and edited and for many years. The City Journal is like that. Every single issue is interesting, challenging, perceptive, and probably capable of hurting my feelings terribly. But we live with that. But beyond all of that, for me, one of the aspects of MI's long history that I feel is irreplaceable is the contribution it's made to education reform in this city. The deep injustice of depriving needy children of an acceptable and satisfactory education has been at the heart of MI's work and concern over the last couple of decades. And it has provided not only the scholarship, but also the kind of meeting place for great minds and activists on this issue. And I think it is one of the most extraordinary contributions to public life in New York City in the last two decades. Well, ladies and gentlemen, today is not only the day of the Alexander Hamilton Award, this is also the year of the Alexander Hamilton the musical. It's a great musical, actually. It's very inspiring. But I wish somehow the seriousness of Hamilton's intellect and argument could be brought to bear on the issues of today. It's perfectly obvious that instead of serious discussion of issues this year, we've had a media circus dominated by rude and vulgar insults. And now we're left with a very unpalatable Hobson's choice, they used to call it, between two politicians, one pandering to interest groups on the left, the other extemporizing a mercantilist economics that I'm afraid promises trade war and arbitrary presidential acts, but might have been said, if are often fact-free and unconstrained by knowledge or experience or wisdom. I think the problem, though, is more fundamental than two candidates who may be not as good as we like, not the ones we'd like. I think what we're all beginning to see is the outlines of a populist revolt on both left and right. And what's disheartening about this revolt is it seems to reject everything we know about what works in economics, trade, and the international order. And a scary part of it is one that accepts very few limits on the scope of presidential power. There seems to be an agreement this year on left and right and in the constituencies of both parties that the assertion of unrestricted presidential power is the way to get some of our problems solved. This is unfortunately a very short-term point of view, and we've seen, in fact, all of us, I suspect, have thought back on history of the 30s when the populist revolts of Germany and Italy and other places led to the belief that a strong leader acting on his own insights and his own peculiar vision of the world should take over from the legislative function. It's a scary prospect. The current upheaval, I think, has been disorienting to most of us. We didn't see it coming. That's a commonplace observation, but you know, every time I ask a friend about it, I get the same reaction. We didn't see it coming. I think we were lulled into, I remember the book by Francis Fukuyama called The End of History. Remember that one? That argued in the mid-80s, I think it was around 86 or 87, that the world had finally come to its senses and realized that sort of a liberal democratic capitalism was the way to go. And as a result of that, the history would fade away. That is to say, everyone would come to realize that that was the case. At the same time, Samuel Huntington was writing The Clash of Civilizations, which seemed to have gotten it a whole bunch more correct. But we were lulled, I think, into thinking that this liberal economic order and the steady economic success that we had and the kind of facsimile of world peace that we seemed to be close to would be accepted as a permanent feature by the American public. And we would only have to tinker around the edges a bit, adjust monetary, get a better Fed chairman. That would help occasionally, pass a government program here or there. But growth, trade, and innovation would do so much for us that no major political adjustments would be required. That didn't happen. We got the Great Recession, for whatever reasons, we won't go into. But at that point, things started to change. And of course, President Obama has advanced the narrative of the undeserving fat cats, that's most of you, taking an unfair share of the pie, and that the other party, those Republicans, were all about defending narrow and selfish interests of the rich. But even on the right, people who didn't buy the sort of left version of that story, we saw the sad spectacle of dysfunctional government, of the VA, Veterans Administration, not working, of most government programs resulting in coming from over-promising and very much under-delivering. And the result was, even in the middle class, government was increasingly seen, especially in the last few years, as a failure. So the narrative's been transformed now. Free market capitalism doesn't work in this narrative. The middle class has been neglected or exploited. Big stick interventions are necessary to redistribute income. Companies that don't do the right thing need to be disciplined. And if Congress doesn't discipline them, personal intervention by the president might do the trick. So all of a sudden, from the end of history in the liberal economic order, so to speak, we have a very different picture. So perhaps like others in this room, I'm depressed, but I'm not yet prepared to reach for my cup of hemlock. It's standing close by, but I'm not ready. I think like most of us in this room, I'm a believer in the power of great ideas, especially the great ideas of an open, free society. Ideas like free markets and free trade and free speech, quaint ideas in this campaign. Rule of law, limited government, resistance to arbitrary state power, suspicion of utopian schemes. These ideas and similar ideas have inspired me ever since I first encountered them as a 17 or 18 or 19 year old, struggling to figure out what these big ideas meant when I came to Cambridge from Van Nuys, California, and ran across those incredible minds that Roger spoke about. I was a freshman, actually, when I took my first course from Henry Kissinger. He assigned 100 books in that one class. And when I asked him, which of these are we supposed to read, he said, "That is for me to know and you to figure out." But I'm optimistic. America has an exceptional history and a resilient political culture. We have a centuries-old tradition. We're actually probably the oldest democratic republic in the world. And this tradition embodies the great ideas of our founders. We have a competitive political system in which those rascals are eventually held responsible for the mess they create. Now, they don't get held responsible as quickly as I like. It reminds me, actually, of my trading life, in which I would have a brilliant idea, and I'd be so early that I'd bloody myself. Paul is smiling. Bloody myself, sometimes for years at a time, because this brilliant idea had to be right. Well, very often the idea was right, but it took an awfully long time for events to play themselves out. The rascals eventually get caught out, but it takes a long time. The consequences of bad economic policy and a bad foreign policy are not observable in the first 3 or 4 or 5 years. There tends to be a long lag, which often results in confusion in elections, who's responsible for which bad thing or which good thing. In the debate that we have, it's very hard to have a serious discussion about that. So I'm optimistic because the DNA of our culture is very, very resilient, our political culture. And I think it will survive whichever of these candidates takes the presidency, whether we oppose them or don't, or vote for them or not, or struggle with some alternative. The American political system will survive. I have another reason that I'm really optimistic, and that's what used to be called quaintly, in Europe anyway, the fourth estate. That's a bunch of you guys in this room as well. The scholars, writers, critics, journalists, analysts, even the internet blogs, tell you something, they're not going to be rolled by demagogues of either left or right. They're going to go down screaming. And I very much hope that those of you in this room who are in charge of screaming will not give up, despite what I take will be years of effort to get the story right. The people who are fighting for all of this, including, I might add, Harvey, whose story and whose work at FIRE are so inspirational, these people are my heroes. This is a fight that's going to take a long time, and we certainly don't know how it's going to end. It well may require a new alignment of political parties or the birth of a new party. I don't know. This seems to me an entirely good thing to allow new arrangements to come into existence. If the old arrangements cannot hold, we better find a way to make new ones that will serve us better. My old mentor, Edward C. Banfield, so the of the the four named professors, the one who didn't get the Hamilton Award because unfortunately he departed before I think the award came into existence. He was actually, in a way, in my mind, the greatest among them, the most unconventional mind among them, and incidentally the teacher of the two younger men, Jim Wilson and Pat Moynihan. He used to remind me in certain moments of his definition of faith. Now, Edward Banfield was not a particularly religious man, so he took particular delight in the definition that I'm about to give you. He said, "Faith is belief despite all evidence to the contrary." Well, despite plenty of evidence to the contrary, my faith is intact. We probably won't go off the rails, even if it looks like we are, and even after this crazy presidential election. We're probably just beginning a new phase in a great national debate on the limits of government and on our core values and on national security. In this debate, I feel certain that the great ideas that have created American political culture will continue to be heard and will win. I'm praying that the great writers and scholars of the Manhattan Institute and their intellectual cousins at the Wall Street Journal or the Weekly Standard or AEI will continue this fight throughout the country. We'll put in a good pitched battle and do it for as many years as is required. So Bill, don't get tired on us. I look forward to this battle. I look forward to the fireworks, and let the best ideas win. I have a little part two now, and that's the fun part. Life is not only politics, especially here in the United States, which has such a strong civil society that we all perhaps take for granted. Maybe that's part of the problem of the populist revolt, but we won't go into that. As Roger said, a very big part of my life is the world of classical music. When business or politics seems discouraging, business is fine, but politics is very discouraging right now, I find refuge, enjoyment, and spiritual solace in great music. And I've been thrilled, privileged to play a very small role, an administrative role, I assure you, nothing more, at some of the great performing arts institutions of New York City. And incidentally, I can see the head of Lincoln Center right in front of me, who does an amazing job, Catherine Farley. Please stand, Catherine. But the vantage point that has inspired me for two decades now is the Juilliard School. 850 students, 300 faculty members, 700 performances a year, and you can go to most of them, a lot of them are free. Degree programs in music, theater, dance. It's an incredible place. It's a magnet for the most talented young performing artists in the world. It's a joy to be at, and it's a jewel, and it's right there in Lincoln Center, and Susie and I are thrilled every time we walk in the building. Tonight, following up on suggestions from Larry and Roger, I thought we'd share some of this joyful music with you. It's a good way to raise the spirits at the end of a lot of depressing speeches. I've brought with me four students, wonderful young artists. They're already great achievers. They have world-class talents, and they're on their way to world-class careers. They're going to play for us two movements from a piece by Brahms, his G minor quartet, piano quartet. It's a work he wrote, get this, at 23. It's a favorite of mine because I think you'll hear it. It communicates optimism and joy. Its energy and joie de vivre can hardly be contained. You'll hear it. We're only going to play two movements, the second movement, which is an intermezzo, and then the fourth movement, which is a gypsy rondo. You won't have any trouble hearing that that Brahms loved gypsy music and it brought him joy. So this is a great piece to close out an evening. It's wonderful to hear, but it's very hard to play. Thank you, everyone, Manhattan Institute, for including me somehow on this list of remarkable recipients for the Hamilton Award. Thank you here in the audience for listening to these musings. And now, for a real treat, wherever they are, please welcome these four marvelous young artists from Juilliard. Thank you. Thank you.
Thank you for that truly beautiful performance. And we wish each of you the very best in your continued studies at Juilliard. I'd like to close very briefly the proceedings by thanking everyone who made tonight's dinner such a success. First, our honorees, Harvey and Bruce, who gave such inspiring and important remarks. And thank you, Heather and Roger, for providing the introductions. I'd also like to thank our chairman, Paul Singer, for his intellectual and financial leadership. And his courage. And the Institute's many supporters, trustees, and our staff, including our development events teams, who did an outstanding job here tonight. I'd especially like to thank Marin Schlossberg, Michael Barrero, Tisha Camacho, and Debbie Ezer. And finally, of course, I'd like to thank all of you who supported this evening's event. As Paul said, we raised more than $2.2 million tonight. It's the second highest amount we've ever raised, and it will go a long way to advance our mission. Dessert will now be served. Please enjoy and leave when you must. You have a gift for everyone on your way out, and if you care to stay for a while, please join us for a post-event cocktail reception in the bar area in the back to your right as you exit. The bar will remain open till 10:30. Good night, and thank you again.